We don't take your presence for granted. And we do welcome again those of you who are on live stream. We do appreciate you being with us so very much. We're grateful that many of you who don't have an opportunity to meet with very many other believers, that we have this opportunity to be with you. Tonight we're going to be in John the 4th chapter, verse 25 through 27. This will be our 48th exposition of this text, this book. Now, those who have had any perceived dealings with Jesus, that is, they know they're dealing with him, will tell you that they're always personal. Jesus never deals with you as like an anonymous member of the human race. It's always personal. You should expect it. When he met Nathanael, remember, he told him, "Before Philip called thee, I saw you under the fig tree." See, it's personal. When teaching at the home of Martha, remember, Martha was upset because Mary wasn't helping her, and she asked Jesus to speak to her, and he said, "Martha, Martha, thou art troubled about many things." Dealt with it personally. One time he told Peter, he says, "Simon," he says, "Satan's desired you to sift you as wheat, but I prayed for you that your faith won't fail." And it didn't. When Jesus confronted the merchandisers in the temple, downright personal about it, said, "You've made my father's house a den of thieves and a house of merchandise." He got personal. None of those men said, "Who's he talking to?" You know, he was personal, very personal. And one time he dealt with his disciples. He said, "What was that you were arguing about along the way?" See, it was personal. They probably would rather he had not brought it up, because they were disputing about who was going to be greatest among them, remember? And when at Simon's house, when that woman of ill fame anointed his feet with ointment and dried him with his hair, and Simon, he was thinking, he didn't say anything, he was thinking it. He addressed Simon. He told Simon, "What you didn't do. You didn't wash my feet." But this woman, she did, because she's thankful, because much she's been forgiven much. And then he even told a woman personally, he says, "Your sins are forgiven." Ooh, how's that? How's that? And then when Jesus upbraided the Pharisees, whew, what a diatribe. He did it face to face. Matthew 23, did face to face to him. Very personal. After he'd risen from the dead, he confronted a couple of disciples on the road to Emmaus that were cast down. He said, "What kind of communications are these that you have? You talking or sad?" And then he spoke candidly about them. They said, "You must not be from around here. Know what's happened. The things that have happened." He said, "Well, what things?" They told him about Christ, and they said this: "We thought he was the one." And he exposed their unbelief to them and led them into faith. Now he's confronted a woman at the well. He's probed her heart. Now you expect this when you deal with Jesus. We want Jesus to be in our gatherings.
Yes, amen.
There's no point to meeting if he's not here.
Right.
Perceptibly here. Yes. There's no point to meeting. But if he's here, you expect your heart will be probed. You don't have to tell us. We already know this is going to happen. Sometimes he'll find good things in you that maybe you didn't know were there. But he's too personal. That's my point. He's personal. He's told this woman at the well, She had five husbands. He told her she was living with someone who wasn't her husband. She told her religion was pointless. They didn't even know who they worshipped. Personal. So we're going to continue now on this personal confrontation. See, a lot of people, because of the condition of what we call Christianity, a lot of people are content to have an impersonal Jesus, just us and them and the blessings of the day, and it's all general. See, it's not personal, but that's not the way God works. Here's our text, verses 25 through 27 of John 4. The woman saith unto him, I know that Messiah cometh, which is called Christ. When he is come, he will tell us all things. Jesus saith unto her, I that speak unto thee am he. And upon this came his disciples and marveled that he talked with the woman. Yet no man said, what seekest thou, or why talkest thou with her? The woman said unto him, now, there's a certain degree of boldness here in this woman talking to a Jew, a man Jew. There's a certain boldness here. There's not a lot of examples of women talking to Jesus in the Bible, just in case you didn't know. So this is one time when Jesus asked who touched him, that woman touched the hem of his garment. When he asked, she came forth fearing and trembling. You see, not a lot of examples of the Syrophoenician woman, remember, that sought him out near Tyre way up north. And sought him out for her daughter, followed him for a long time. She talked with him, but she wasn't brash about it. Not many examples of it happening. So I gather that this is an example of God drawing somebody to Jesus. That's what this is. That's what we're witnessing. Yeah. Jesus said, no man can come to me except the Father sent me draw him. No man means no member of the human race. Right. No one can come to me except the Father sent me draw him. So I gather this was God drawing. The woman didn't know he was being drawn, but drawing her to Jesus, which meant he gave her the required boldness to actually hold a dialogue. Actually hold a dialogue with Jesus. She didn't know who this was, but she could tell right off that this was at least a prophet. She knew this is a distinguished person, and yet she had the boldness to speak with him. So if you've been bold enough to come to the Lord with your petitions, I'm telling you that God's been drawing you there.
Yeah, amen.
And you have a right to expect good things. Yes. See, so you be of good cheer. Natural and cultural hindrances, they were just overcome. In a moment of time, people talk about the culture and all this kind of thing. It was all overcome. This was certainly against the culture, I'll tell you that. In fact, I took the time, I won't share it with you, but I took the time to look up some Jewish tradition in the Torah.
Yeah.
Is it the Torah?
Yeah, the Torah is the law.
Yeah, what's the other one?
Talmud.
In the Talmud. That a man was not to talk to a woman in a public place, even to his wife. That's in the Talmud. That's in Jewish tradition. So this was a most unique thing. So she said, now, I know. Well, that was quite a statement, I know. Actually, this was just an intellectual no. She really didn't know this in the sense that it can be known. The Samaritans did not perceive the prophets as being from God. They didn't accept the prophets, their writings, but they did accept Moses. And so however she thought she knew ultimately was traced back to Moses, but it was through the Samaritan culture. knowing when you say, I know, like I know whom I have believed, you know, that's a different kind of know than I know that the Messiah is coming. That's a different kind of know. We know that we're of God and the whole world lieth in wickedness. See, that's a different kind of know than this know here. This would be equivalent, like I know the Bible says, you know, something like that. This is the kind of knowledge that Paul said Agrippa had. Agrippa had this kind of knowledge. He said, Paul told him, you're expert in all customs and questions which are among the Jews. So Agrippa, he did this to be familiar with the people over whom he was given responsibility. But if you wanted to know about the Jews, you didn't go to Agrippa to find out about it. You might be surprised with the people some go to learn about the Bible and Jesus. You might just be surprised who they go to. But the kind of knowledge Agrippa had, that's the kind of knowledge that this woman had. And you remember that when Paul reasoned with him, testified to him, Agrippa said, almost thou persuadest me to become a Christian. Almost, not quite, but almost. There's a song we used to sing years ago when things used to be a little more sensitive at church. We used to go, almost persuaded, almost but lost. Some of those invitation songs, they'd scare people today. Well, they scare people today. Almost. He had an intellectual and rudimentary grasp. But it's persuasion that's the point.
Amen.
Knowing what the Bible says is good, but it's not best.
Yeah.
At some point, you have to get where you do know what it says. At some point, that has to happen. But it's being persuaded. That is the truth. That's what makes the difference. So I don't know if this woman was persuaded that Christ would come when she said we know, but I have an idea this was more intellectual. Now, this is one of the greatest weaknesses of contemporary Christianity. The knowledge that it promotes is more like Agrippa's knowledge and the Samaritan woman knowledge. It's actually more that kind of knowledge, and a lot of preaching is the world's knowledge is mingled in with it. It's all kind of mixed up into a sort of a spiritual hash. That's a combination of some thoughts that are from Scripture, and some thoughts are from men, and some thoughts are personal, and some thoughts are cultured. It's all kind of mixed together in a sort of a speech blender.
Some people will assume, well, this is not so bad, I mean, to have this kind of knowledge, but see, a greater than Moses is here.
That's right.
There's a greater revelation that's been revealed to us in our age. It's just wrong to just have a summary knowledge.
See, it's not that this is unlawful, it's that it's unprofitable.
Yeah, that's right.
Uh-huh. Is it right? Is it wrong? Those aren't the ultimate questions. That won't settle. Is it right? Is it wrong? That won't settle. Is it profitable? Is it unprofitable? That's the real issue. Now I know that Messiah. That's a transliteration of the word Messiah. Transliteration is changed the Greek letter to English letters. Because there's not an appropriate word in the English language to convey this thought of a Messiah. I know you must know this, but human speech cannot develop a nomenclature that goes beyond human experience. This is like impossible. It can't be done. That's why there is no language where words like eternal. They always accommodate it to some forever and ever, age without, world without end, ages. See, they're trying to come because there's no word that actually, baptism is a word like that. It's a transliteration. There's no English word for it. Messiah is that kind of word. The idea in the English language, apart from being affected by Scripture, there isn't any kind of term that teaches that a super deliverer is coming. It's going to get us out of this mess. That's why some men rise up and say, I'm the guy, you know. It's a Hitler rose up, say, I'm the one, I'm the... It's because the term Messiah doesn't mean anything to someone that doesn't know about God. Doesn't mean anything. Jesus, I know Messiah comes. You know, I gather that they were thinking of him more as a kind of a walking dictionary, you know, walking encyclopedia. He'll tell us everything. He'll tell us about everything. I know he's coming. Now, they did accept, they didn't accept the prophets. They did accept Moses. And so Moses gave three prophecies about the coming Christ. One's in Genesis, where God preached the gospel to the devil with the whole human race present. And he said that the seed of the woman would bruise the head of the serpent, and the serpent bruises his heel. All right, that's one. You're going to give a devastating blow to the enemy. That was one. Then in Deuteronomy, or in Genesis 49:10, Jacob gave a prophecy. He said that the scepter, the means of rule, will not depart from Judah, nor a lawgiver from between his feet till Shiloh come, that's Messiah, and unto him shall the gathering of the people be. So there we're going to be. See, the people didn't gather to Moses. Moses gathered the people, see. Up to this point, someone gathered the people. But there's going to be a Messiah, the people would gather. Oh, boy, this is good, you know that? The people would come to him. That was a prophecy. And in Deuteronomy 18, verses 18 and 19 said, I will raise up a prophet from among the brethren like unto thee, like unto Moses. I will put my words in his mouth. He shall speak unto them all that I command him. The woman said, tell us all things. He will speak all that I command him. And it shall come to pass that whosoever will not hearken to my words, which he shall speak in my name, I will require it of him. Whew. Now, Peter preached that on the day of Pentecost in Acts 3, 22 and 23. That exact quote he gave that. I'm gonna take what I want to communicate to the human race, and I'm going to give it to a special prophet I'm going to raise up. He's going to tell the people what I want them to know. And if they don't pay attention to him, Peter said they'll be destroyed from among the people.
That's right. Amen. Yes.
So people need to listen up.
Amen.
God meant that when he said that. Now that woman gathered, she knew from that text, he'll tell us all things, not all things about us, that's not what she meant. He'll tell us all things we need to know from God. Now, I don't think professing Christendom thinks of Jesus this way, and delivering words of God to us. In fact, in the movement with which I was identified, there's a considerable number of the people, including professed scholars, that say that Jesus' words were spoken under the Old Covenant and that they don't apply to people under the New Covenant. Well, this is dogmatically taught. I have sat with these people. We've discussed this heresy. But that's not true. Jesus said, the words I speak unto you, they are spirit, and they are life.
Amen.
And he told him, my words will never pass away. See, so if that's all I knew about it, I could just discard that other teaching very easily. He will tell us all things. That, as I said, matches the promise of Moses. He shall speak unto them all that I shall command them. Moses' prophecy was not that Jesus would reveal what was in man. Moses could do that. The psalmist could do that, you know. He was going to reveal what God what was essential.
Yeah, yeah.
I want to emphasize that. What was essential for men to know about God and about his salvation. There are some things men have got to know about God and about his great salvation.
Yeah.
He can't depend on men themselves to do it. So Jesus is actually the one who does it. He'll do it through people. I understand that. But then the people taught by people have to again be taught by Jesus, who has come to give us an understanding that we might know him that is true. See? So Jesus is the ultimate one to teach you about these things. Yes?
That's why whenever you preach and teach, you got to preach and teach the truth, because Jesus won't open it up any other way. So if someone's preaching something that's not the truth, their understanding's not going to be opened up at that time with that kind of preaching.
God won't use a lie to delineate the truth. He will not do this. Says,
no man knows the Father but the Son.
That's right.
Yeah.
And he to whom the Son wills to reveal
it. That's right.
Matthew 11:27. You say, well, there you are. Well, who does he want to reveal him to? The next verse says, come unto me, all ye that labor. That's the next verse.
Amen.
So he wants to reveal him to whoever wants to know.
Yeah. Amen.
Isn't that good to know?
Yes, it is.
So declaring to the people what God wanted them, what God required that they know in order for him to regenerate them, guide them, keep them from falling, keep them by his power. In order for them to know, there's some things they have to know. Not things they have to feel, things they have to know. And when you know in this sense, you do feel it. Yeah, Brother Judah.
Thing we just said, that Jesus wants to reveal whoever wants to know. This knowledge isn't just static information. It's just knowledge that you store away. Okay, I've got that now. I can apply it when I need it.
Yeah.
This knowledge, you've got to do something with what you know.
That's right.
So if you know that Christ is the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords, then you're going to submit yourself to him.
Yeah.
And if you know that he is willing to reveal the Father to you, if you come to him, then you'll go.
That's right. Yeah, if you really know what the law of gravity is, you're not about to jump off a tower.
That's right. Yeah.
You know that.
Uh-huh. You can see that
this lady was thinking about these things before she come to the world.
Oh, yeah.
Because she didn't say, isn't the grain prices are really gone up. She's talking about things that she wants to know about.
Yeah. She didn't say, what's the secret to having a good marriage? I had 5 bad ones. But people are taught to do that. Listen, brethren, people are taught to do this today.
Yeah.
And the teaching hasn't been too successful, as the statistics can tell you. Not been too successful. Now, when Jesus was among men, he clarified what Moses said. He clarified it. He said, my doctrine is not mine, but his has sent me. That's John 7:16. John 8:28, as my Father taught me, I speak these things. This is the all things that the woman was talking about. For I have not spoken of myself, that is, I'm not telling you my thoughts on the fly that I had. But the Father which sent me, he gave me a commandment what I should say and what I should speak. Boy, that's pretty poignant.
Yeah. Amen.
The word which ye hear is not mine, but the Father which has sent me. John 14:24. So Jesus, this is the all things we're talking about. It simply is not possible that they pertained only to the 6-month period in which he ministered. In which he had ministered up to this point. Now Jesus saith unto her, I that speak unto thee am he. Now this woman had admitted, I know that Messiah is coming. This was apparent general knowledge among even the Samaritans. Even among the Samaritans, they were expecting a great deliverer of some sort to come. And we don't know how this knowledge was obtained. It's not spelled out. But it was a direct knowledge. That is, the Samaritans didn't have a prophet sent from God that told them this. They derived this from what they knew about Moses. They couldn't have studied nature and concluded this, because nature doesn't have enough resources to come to this conclusion that Jesus was sent from God. You can't conclude that by anything that's in the world. Ultimately, this probably is traced back to the time when the king of Assyria, after they had overcome and captured Israel, the foreigners were imported into the land. Some few people had been left in the land, and they had intermarried. And this was defiling the land. So God sent some lions. God did. God sent some lions down there to kill some of these people. And the people said, whoa. They went to the king and says, look, the God of this land, which God has said that's his land, the God of this land, the people don't know how to worship him. So that's why he's doing this. The king said, well, then you go get a priest. That we had, when we carried one priest captive, find a priest that'll come down here and teach these people how to fear God. Boy, would that be good if someone said that had to be done in the United States?
Yeah.
Just think of a president, the Congress, and everybody stood up and said, look, we got to have somebody come down here and tell us what to do to please God.
Yeah.
Well, would that be something?
Yeah.
Well, it was something then, too.
Yes, that's right.
It was God. So the priest come down. Here's what the record says.
Mm-hmm.
2 Kings 17. The king said, carry thither one of the priests whom ye brought from thence, and let them go down and dwell there. Let them teach the people the manner of the God of the land. Then one of the priests whom they had carried away from Samaria came and dwelt in Bethel and taught them how they should fear the Lord.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
I gather that this knowledge the Samaritans had ultimately was traced back to that priest, whatever he taught him. It must have been something from Moses. So that'd be what I would call the ultimate source. And then keep in mind that event took place 750 years before what we're reading about. And so who but God could do this? This couldn't have happened by happenstance. It just takes a century, and it cleans out the minds of most people of the past.
That's right.
Yep. Just a few decades, they forget great epoch. People already forgot like 9/11.
Yeah, that's right. Yep.
Churches are filled up for a couple of weeks. So this is remarkable. This is God. See, he kept this little, just a little chip off a diamond.
Yeah.
He kept this alive. So when Jesus came, then he's going to work with it. I did want to say a word about our times in view of this. Here's the Samaritans. They're not a people. They don't know who they're worshiping. Their religion is, from one point of view, vain. But they did know that a Messiah was coming, which is Christ. I get that's John's interpretation of when they said it, the Messiah, that he said, which is Christ, in brackets, that's John's editorial remark. Now, this is a time when the Samaritans were expecting a Messiah. And there were others. There were others at that time when Jesus was here, others at that time who were waiting for the kingdom of God. That's Mark 15:43. Still others were looking for redemption. I'm teaching expectation. There was a spirit of expectation when Jesus came the first time. They looked for redemption in Jerusalem. When John the Baptist became his preaching, the people were in expectation. They even thought maybe this is the Christ. There was everything, anticipation. was elevated. After Philip confronted Jesus, he went to goes to Nathanael and says, "We found him of whom Moses in the law and in the prophets did write." See, they knew what Moses and the prophets said, but they were looking to find some. We found him. We found the one. See, there was a spirit of expectation among the people. Not knowing Jesus was going to rise from the dead, the two on the road to Emmaus spoke for all the other disciples as we thought that it had been him that should have redeemed Israel. See, they had this expectancy. Amen. Now, it's with the element of sadness that I must say this, but this spirit of expectancy is almost totally absent in our age. We live by hope, see?
That's right.
But hope, expectancy, anticipation, it's almost defunct in our time. Uh-huh. In fact, people are anticipating like the Antichrist.
Yeah.
Uh-huh.
Yeah.
Yeah. Oh, yeah, that's what they're told is oncoming. World calamity.
Uh-huh.
Now, these things are coming. I mean, I understand that, but that's not what you preach.
No.
Expectation. They don't know enough about Jesus to recognize when he was really here. If Jesus really did turn up at some assemblies, they would have no idea that he did.
Yeah.
They don't have a cogent thought about who Jesus is and what Jesus does. They don't know. A spirit of expectancy. Now, this has taken place in a phenomenal amount of preaching and teaching and seminars and workshops and all kinds of conventions and colleges. And with all of that, these men have produced an environment in which the people do not live in anticipation. And because they don't, they aren't looking. They're not looking for Christ because they don't expect it. They're not living by hope because they don't think about Jesus coming. If they think about Jesus coming, it scares them rather than comforts them.
People who profess to be Christians who don't even believe that it's literal whatsoever.
Yes.
Mm.
We were saying about Babylon is falling. That's what we're talking about.
Right.
And religious professionals have dealt a devastating blow to society, to the society to whom they supposedly are ministering. See, they've turned the thinking of people that did come to Christ has been skewed off. They're thinking about life in this world and how to optimize life in this. That's what they're thinking about. For this marital life, business life, financial life, health life, whatever. But their thinking has been turned. And hope doesn't thrive with those kind of expectations. Christ's coming doesn't mean anything. Because Christ's coming is going to interrupt all marriages.
Amen.
It's going to terminate all wealth.
Yeah.
See, it's going to end all worldly governments. So you don't think of Christ coming if you're absorbed with domestic and social corrections that need to be made. Now, the relevance of this to our text is that the woman knew enough so Jesus could frankly say to her, "I am he." See, she knew enough, so those words meant something to her. I am he. Now, as men grow up into Christ in all things, which is what God intends for them to do, more and more Jesus will speak this to their hearts, "I am he." More and more. This will happen more and more. I know you've experienced considerable this already. Let me just say a few words about this. When you believe such things as that Jesus is the door, which deals with the entrance, Jesus is the vine, a life source, that Jesus is the way, access, that Jesus is the truth, You accept this now, ultimate reality, that Jesus is the life, reciprocity with God, that Jesus is the bread of life, nourishment for the soul, that Jesus is the light of the world, illumination. Jesus is the good shepherd, guidance and care. Jesus is the resurrection of the life, reality and vitality. When you believe that, first of all, some people don't even know those things. So the function of the church is to inform the people of who Jesus is. When they actually embrace it and they begin to want those things,
yeah.
See?
Uh-huh.
See
yeah.
Where I'm going here?
That's right.
They embrace it.
That's right.
I want that. I want that kind of bread.
Yeah.
Jesus will, to their hearts, he'll say, I'm he.
Yeah, amen. That's right. Yeah.
Now that opens up the real function of ministry, which among other things is to make people conscious of who Jesus is. If they're born again, they're already growing discontent with the world, see? So all of a sudden, this awakens a longing for this, the kind of things Jesus says he does.
Amen.
And then Jesus will come in, he'll manifest himself to them.
Yeah.
That's what he said. He said, if any man love me and keep my words, I will come into him and manifest myself to him.
Yes,
it's John 14:21. And when he does, he'll confirm to you, I'm the one.
Yeah,
yeah, Brother Jason?
I was just thinking that it's very interesting that Jesus was so frank with this woman, because he wasn't this frank with the Jews.
That's right.
He never came right out publicly and said to the Jews, I'm the Messiah or I'm the Christ.
That's right.
But like he did to this woman. And I think the reason for that is because they weren't able to receive that. The Jews had their own agenda for the Christ. They thought they knew what the Christ was going to be and do, but it wasn't in harmony with what Jesus was sent to do. And so he never revealed that to them. But he could reveal that to this woman.
Amen. Yeah. That's very good.
Amen. Yeah.
See, this highlights when you... there's several ways you could summarize preaching and teaching. Like you got to come up to a total. One is that this world's not it. I mean, the preaching's got to lead people to that conclusion. It's not here. But don't build your life around this world.
Yeah.
And it's got to come up to the fact that God has provided a way out of this mess.
Yeah.
It's got to. Preacher got to lead people to that conclusion. You've got to lead people to the conclusion that Jesus is the total answer.
Amen. Yes.
Not a partial answer. He's a total answer. You're complete in him. Got to lead people
Amen.
To that conclusion. So when you preach and when you teach, how I want to do better at this.
Yeah.
I don't want to cloud the air. There's enough clouds already. When you do this, it sensitizes the soul. So now there can be there could be this communication, see, from God, and confidence is going to come from this communication, not from this communication. You can't build confidence this way. It's built this way. So that, and you'll find if you commit yourself to do this, you'll find that Jesus is everywhere. That you can't preach on any or teach on any legitimate subject without having to bring Christ into the matter. You'll find it's that way. All right, he told us, and now upon this came the disciples. They returned. They went to town to get something to eat, remember. And they, upon this, I am he. Upon this, here they disciples come upon this. In other words, read at this point, or just then, or immediately, or upon that, or at that time, or while he was speaking, or at that moment. I'm saying that this was timed by God. These disciples turned up when God wanted them to turn up. Wasn't after they finished the dialogue and the woman went back. They came while he was speaking to this woman. It's this divine working. See, Jesus said, I only do what the Father told me to do.
Yes.
The works that I do aren't mine. They're the fathers. Now, we learn from Scripture that God does frequently interrupt what men are doing. And, of course, there's an endless list of things like that, things like he interrupted Adam and Eve. Where art thou? You know, he interrupted them. He interrupted Cain. What hast thou done? See, he interrupted Cain. He interrupted the world by the flood. That was a gigantic interruption. The building of the tower at Shinar in the city, God interrupted that. He interrupted Nebuchadnezzar's reign. Remember, Nebuchadnezzar said, "Is not this great Babylon as I built?" A bang, God immediately said. He told, he'd already heard from Daniel this was going to happen. He says, "Right, I'm going to take the kingdom from you. They're going to drive you out. You're going to be with the beasts until you know that the Most High rules." And immediately God interrupted Nebuchadnezzar's reign. So there's a lot of this in Scripture. But men never interrupt God. God can interrupt men, but men never interrupt God, what God's doing. I'm saying that God had an appointment with this woman at the well. Before this thing is over, there's going to be a whole lot of people out of Samaria is going to believe. Because of this event, started up Jesus sitting on a well asking for a drink of water. It starts out that way. It ended up and staying 2 days, and a whole host of people believed on it. God set that whole thing up. When he completed his witness, then the disciples came. And wouldn't you know, they marveled that he talked with the woman. What's he doing? At this point of his ministry, it does not appear the disciples had ever seen Jesus talk to a woman, far as the record's concerned, apart from this woman. The first woman Jesus talked to was the woman with the issue of blood. So this was not an everyday occurrence, to say the least. This is not to be used to establish what's right and what's wrong. They marveled. This didn't mean Jesus avoided speaking to women. He didn't. Like some of his close disciples were women. Mary Magdalene, out of whom he said, he has seven devils. She followed him everywhere he went. They marveled at what they saw. Other versions said they were surprised. The New Revised Standard Version said they were astonished. Say, astonished at what? That he talked with this woman. We're astonished. They were shocked, the Holman Bible says. They wondered that he spoke with a woman, Darby says. They were greatly surprised, the Good News Bible. And they wondered, were surprised and astonished, the Amplified Bible. Why? They marveled. Jesus did something they didn't think he'd do. Roughly translated means they didn't know him like they should. They weren't that acquainted with Jesus. This wasn't the 12. The 12 hadn't been chosen yet. This was I don't know how many it was, but they were just introduced to Jesus. So much so, they knew so little about Jesus that they were surprised he talked with a woman. Well, of course, that probably would surprise some people today, too. Well, this isn't the only time this happened. When Jesus stilled the tempest and quieted the winds, remember that storm? His disciples were sore amazed in themselves beyond measure and wondered. See, what manner of man is this? Commands the winds and... See, he did something they didn't think he'd do. When Jesus told his disciples it was more difficult for a rich man to be saved than for a camel to go through the eye of a needle, they were exceedingly amazed. Whoa. In fact, they asked, who then can be saved? Jesus said, well, with men this is impossible. What's impossible? To be saved. With men it is impossible. But with God all things are possible. The point I'm making out here is how the disciples marveled, were surprised. When Jesus cursed the fig tree, withered and died, they marveled. See? They did not expect Jesus would do something like this. Now, this didn't happen after Pentecost. This kind of surprise is not registered when Peter said to Dorcas, "Tabitha, arise." He wasn't surprised that she did. She wasn't surprised. When Peter told a playman, "Rise up and walk," he was, "Whoa, boy, look at that, Johnny actually did." He wasn't surprised. Why? What? Because they had been filled with the Spirit. They'd been regenerated. They had the mind of Christ. Amen. See? That happens. When you grow up into Christ, you're not surprised so much when the Lord works. Yes?
I don't think those disciples would have even been in Samaria if it wasn't for Jesus. One of the things that these men had to learn, they had to learn to go with Jesus' agenda.
Amen.
That's what being a disciple
Amen.
Means.
Amen.
And at times you see them, sometimes that surprises them where he's taking them. But they had to learn. See,
that's right.
That's what discipleship is. You've got to get rid of your agenda, whatever it is.
Good.
And you've got to accept his agenda.
Appreciate it. That's good stuff. Yeah. See, that's good news.
That's one thing we can do.
That's right. Amen.
As to lay out some exploit for you to do. Yes, Sister June.
This was a little bit of groundwork. Also, whenever the gospel was sent to the Gentiles,
mm-hmm.
And they saw that here are the Samaritans that weren't fully Jews and were despised by the Jews. Here they were believing on Jesus.
Yeah.
Now that would be something in their recollection when they were having their conference about whether or not that salvation was being offered
Amen.
To the Gentiles.
Amen.
Shows us also that Jesus is eager to be known as the Savior of all men.
Yeah.
Uh-huh. This is how he wants to be known. If you grow up into Christ in all things, which is the target, Ephesians 4:15, that's the purpose for the church in the aggregate. That's what Ephesians 4:11 through 16, it spells it out so that a person just has to be deprived of wisdom like the ostrich not to see it. When you grow up into Christ in all things, you're not surprised at the workings of the Lord. They all make sense to you. Why? Because he brings you up into heavenly places, sits you with Christ in heavenly places. And up here in this domain, things God does make sense and the world doesn't make sense. See? When you're down here, what the world does make sense, up here doesn't make sense. You got to decide which realm you're going to live in.
Amen.
If you live in this realm, what God does, you have a growing. This is an area of growth. You'll grow in this. You'll be able to say, that's the Lord.
Yeah.
See? Uh-huh. You'll be able to say that.
Amen.
Yes.
I was also thinking about this when you mentioned the interruptions of the Lord, that as we grow, they won't necessarily be an interruption anymore. Because it's more of a directing.
Amen.
Whenever the Lord does that, he's turning our attention.
Amen.
And then it's our desire. We see and understand why he's pointing us that way, and it's our desire to follow.
Amen.
Amen. Yeah, for some people, to have an illuminated thought is a big interruption. Yeah. Yes, but Jesus.
This, what Jesus was doing here, though, was in no way in contradiction to things that God had previously done and revealed.
That's right.
But the Jews had forgotten. See, they had failed to consider the fact that God sent Jonah to Nineveh.
Yeah.
Now, the Ninevites were total pagans.
That's right.
But he sent them to Nineveh. Jonah to Nineveh.
Yeah.
God, through the prophets, he addressed other nations. Mm-hmm. He addressed Babylon through the prophet Isaiah and Jeremiah. So God is... Yes, the Jews were the chosen people, but this did not mean at all that God was ignoring the rest of the world.
That's right.
See, but they had over the course of time, they had neglected to remember that he was the God of all the nations,
that's
and he
right.
did have care for the nations.
Uh-huh.
So they shouldn't have been surprised that Jesus, being from God, would be interested in the Samaritans.
That's right.
And the prophets, you know, several of the prophets delivered judgments against the heathen nations, which said God's eye was on them. And that he held out hope to many of them. Like to Nineveh, they're a living example of somebody that believed what God said.
And they were
students of history itself. They would know, well, what if the spies hadn't listened to Rahab? Yeah. I mean, they're, and then she ends up being in Christ's lineage. I mean,
or Ruth.
I mean, this was known.
You see, the Pharisees had produced a fraudulent religious environment, scribes and Pharisees and people like that, which led people into this area where you don't, there's some things you just don't think about. And I think this has happened in our day. There's sufficient examples of every kind of response God can have, favorable and unfavorable. There's examples in Scripture that define what God will do under this circumstance or that circumstance. But if the people don't know about it, they won't think about it.
Yeah, that's right.
Brother Jason is right. They shouldn't have been surprised, but they were. And we do want to seek not to be constantly surprised.
Amen.
What God does. Yeah. The text adds, yet no man said, no one responded to it. No one said, why are you talking with her? I wonder what that's all about. What do you want? Why are you talking with her? What's your purpose? Why are you talking to her? What do you want from her? Why or what? Yeah, they've been discussing. What are you inquiring about? What do you want? See, they didn't. Now, Peter sometimes, he spoke right out, but he didn't hear. James and John, they weren't hesitant to say, could we sit on your one on the right hand, one on the left? See, they reported, but they didn't speak out here. And what are people that say, why did God do it? Why am I experiencing these things? What about that? They didn't dare ask Jesus.
Yeah.
They knew enough about Jesus to say, you don't ask him why he's doing what he's doing. You just, they've been close enough to Jesus to know that. So why do people question what God does? Because they're not close enough to know. You don't do this. This is not what you do.
Yeah.
If you wonder why something bad's happened, do you think this way? Well, I know good reason why a lot more bad things could have happened to me than have.
Right. Yeah.
I mean, we could be a lot worse, justly a lot worse than it is.
Amen.
Does anyone have a right to say to God, why hast thou made me thus? Why did you make me this way? Would it be right for me to say to God, how come in my old age I'm getting sick? Why do I hurt more than I feel good? See, I don't have a right to ask that question.
Yeah.
I already know the answer to it anyway.
Yeah.
But
yeah.
What is the Lord doing anyway? See, no one has a right to ask this question. Why am I not enjoying? Why did that person see it, but I didn't see it? See, you got. Just be thankful somebody saw it. Because
right.
In the kingdom of God, whoever sees it is to tell it.
Yeah, that's right. Amen.
So don't say, well, I wish I'd have seen that first. Be glad they saw it.
Yeah,
be
right.
glad that they were disposed to tell you what they saw.
Yeah.
That's how the kingdom works. See, it
that's
teaches
right.
you to be unselfish. The people of God should be noted for saying, now thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. See?
Yeah.
Or when it was revealed that Paul was going to be imprisoned when he went to Rome. A prophet, Agabus, told that. The disciples interpreted that to mean he shouldn't go to Rome.
But that's not what the prophecy was for. I think Agabus thought that too, but the prophecy was to get Paul ready for what was going to happen. So when they finally realized, we're not going to change his mind, then all of them said, the will of the Lord be done. Yeah. See, that's what to do. That's what to do. Yeah. When you can't change something with all your arguments and so forth, the will of the Lord be done.
Yes. Amen.
When Job was confronted with divine interrogation, he'd ask some questions, you know. Then God said, gird up your loins like a man now, and I'm going to ask you some questions. God said to Job, here was Job's answer. Behold, I am vile. What shall I answer thee? I will lay my hand upon my mouth. Once I have spoken, I will not answer. Yea, twice I'll proceed no further. I'll not argue about this anymore.
Amen.
Well, the disciples intuitively knew this. And I wouldn't doubt but that Jesus explained this to him later on sometime, commented on it. But now you have an example here of a non-covenanted person with just a smattering of knowledge. Yet they were brought to want what Jesus had. And before this is over, she'll be given it.
Yes,
now that should ignite the light of hope in every soul.
Amen.
Every soul should be of good cheer. Yes.
On a practical note, to avoid this situation where we're like surprised by something that God would do or something that God would say, a very practical remedy for that, a lot of people these days don't do, is to read every part of Scripture.
Yeah.
Familiarize yourself with every part of the Word of God. Read all of it, the whole counsel of God. A lot of people don't do this. Even Christian people don't do this. Most people have never actually read the entire Bible and expose themselves. A lot of churches don't expose themselves regularly to different parts of Scripture. We tend to gravitate to those parts that are kind of our favorite or that speak directly to us on some simple level. But there's parts of Scripture that challenge us, that enlarge our view of God. We got to have every part of the Word of God to know the Lord.
Amen.
Amen. Mm-hmm. We live by every. See, God's nature is embedded in what He has revealed.
Amen.
So you learn about, you're not just learning, as Brother Jason's pointing out, you're just not learning facts or the more important facts, you're learning God and Christ in this select body. This is a select, deliberate body of knowledge. Written over a period of 1,600 years by 40 men, moved of God, who all spoke in perfect accord, spanning 16 centuries, all spoke in perfect accord and harmony. You could not account, this is like a library. You cannot account for this book apart from God. Yeah. Judah?
See from this revelation of Christ, Christ says, I am He. And at that point, He is revealed to this woman. The next verse says the woman left her water pot and went her way into the city.
Yeah.
So you can see when Christ is revealed to you, you're not going to keep quiet about it.
That's right.
This woman went into the city and told everybody, come and see a man which told me all that ever
That's
I did.
Right.
Is not this the Christ? And then they came out.
They came out.
And later they said, now we believe. Not because of what you said. Now we've heard Him for ourselves.
That's right.
And now we believe. So when Christ is revealed, then it's not going to happen in a quarter and stay a quiet matter.
Yeah.
That's going to lead to belief. And belief, the rest is history, I guess you could say. That's not a very good way of saying it. But that's the way the Lord works. When you can see Him for who He is, God can start working.
If you can get people to Jesus, now that's the challenge. But if you can get people to Jesus, it'll end up correcting what needs to be corrected. And enhancing what needs to be enhanced. It'll do it, but that's a secret. Philip find Nathaniel, he brought him. Andrew, he brought Peter. Once Peter got to Jesus, then Jesus told him what he wanted Peter to know. So that's the objective, not to get them to adopt an agenda or to accept a certain institution, to get them to Jesus. Those Greeks said to Philip, I believe, sirs, we would see Jesus. And so they got to see him. Anyone else tonight? All right, Mr. Barb. Oh, Brother Tony.
I agree with Brother Jason. I'm going to read the whole Bible. I just got done reading Numbers, and I am reading it with everything I have. I just got done reading it. Everything in there is crucial.
Yes, right.
Everything is. So I want to make sure I understand it.
That's good.
Yeah.
Amen.
Lord will bless you, Brother Tony.
Amen.
That's right.
You're not reading alone.
Yeah.
Amen.
All right.